Again, undercuts. Yeah, it's a mini pot. You can see our simple cap, just each bottle cap. You can see the thread is inside. That is the undercut. This is where we are opening the pot. So the tool will be opening like this way. The pot will be like this way. You can see this feature is like undercut. So it will undercut when it will stuck in the tool. So it will not easily release from the tool. So how we are going to release these undercuts? That is the main thing. So you can see some of the snap feature, they're adding some simple holes. Just simply for the holes, we can just adding some material to release this undercut. But other features, suppose we don't need this hole here. So then we need to add some kind of extra side action to release this undercut. And coming to the basic processing. So if we take it as an injection molding cycle, so this is a major portion. So, but in the basics, I'll just cover in 2-3 slides, but this is very major. So in that molding simulation classes, we are going to mostly focus on this basic processing one, like a processing one. So coming to that, it's a basic processing. It's having a mold closing and injection and packing, cooling and mold open and ejection. These are the steps involved in the basic processing. And here you can see the percentage of each cycle. So mold open and close, it's about 15%. Right. And coming to the fill time, it's a very, very smallest portion. So it's just a 2%. And packing and holding, so it's about 13%. And remaining percentage, it fills with all cooling and recovery. And again, this next smallest portion is ejection. So this is a basic structure of a molding machine. So here you can see this portion, this is called as you can see it's an injection unit. And here the second portion, it's called as an entire clamping unit. So injection portion means it's here the hopper. So they will feed the material inside. So this is called a screw. You can call it as a screw. It's a reciprocating screw. It will rotate and it will acting as a plunger. It will just push the material. While the screw have a three portion, like it's a feeding zone and transmitting zone and front zone. So the feeding zone, all the material, it will go and just it will feed inside. It will ready for the melting. So the transferring zone means the screw depth will be gradually reduces. It will just start melting all the material. It's having a two forces, like one is a temperature. So they are using all heaters. It will heat the barrel. And again, the friction heat, it will again start melting the material. And after that front, you can see all it's a storing area. The material will be stored in the front. It will ready for the next shot. So then the screw will be just push it front. It will further while closing the mold. It will just push it. So the center, you can see this is the mold. So this is where we see that. So the processing, we have to control injection unit and clamping unit and the cooling of the mold. This is where the processing is. This is the one we are going to simulate in the Autodesk Moldflow simulation software. So here we need to understand the basic physics of the injection molding machine. So how the material is, it's ready for the shot. So how it is making the material in the molten state in the exact what is the range? Because here it's having a lot of heaters. So we can set the temperature because we cannot. So suppose if we take it as a polypropylene material, it needs 220 degrees centigrade. I cannot keep the heater 220 degrees centigrade because it needs some friction. It will create some friction heat also. It will add while starting that machine. So it will go for some 2-3 shots. Just it's called as a trial shot. So they'll do a trial shot to bring that all the molten material in a standard or a homogeneous state. That physics we need to know. So how the molten state, what time it reaches the molten state. So that is very important. And come to the material. So here we need to know the physical property of material. So no need to know the chemical property of material. So because it's having a different way. So to understand the physical property, like what is the viscosity of material. So we can say it's a melt flow rate. So how the material will be flows and what is the rheological behavior? So how the material will be flow, while shearing, how the material will behave. So whether it's while shearing through the section material will, again, it will react for the shear or it will not react for the shear. Because some material, we can say it's a shear sensitive material. Suppose if we take it as a little B dot I styrene, like ABS, it's a shear sensitive material. We should not keep that material shear too much. because if you shear, it will easily degrade, like it loses all the properties. So while forming the part, so you are expecting some 10,000 megapascal for the material strength, but you will get just 2,000 only because of the degradation, it's totally lost that property. So in that case, we need to know that material behavior, physical property of this material. And coming to the, this is a complex part. So it's a mold. So we should know how the mold is. So the later slides, I will explain how the mold should be and what are the types of mold we are going to use. And it, the mold have a lot of elements. Elements have a different design principles that we need to know that. So then only we can give that the customer or who are the people give to us for the simulation, we can give 100% output. Otherwise, it will be like a half cooked. Now move on to the tool design. So this is another part. It's the last part. The tool design is very important because each part have a different shapes and different needs for each part. So we have to make the surfaces and textures and feature forming in the correct way. So we have to allow the material in the inside the cavity should be filled properly and cool properly. So molding cycle, it's the biggest influence of output, the final part, because the tool is creating an internal stress in the part. So we need to reduce the internal stress and create a quality part. So for that, we need the proper tool design. So we have a three types of mold design. So it's a two plate and three plate and stack molding. Let's see that it's a very simple construction. It's a two plates. You can see that it have just two halves. It's for a simple part mostly, but this is a very common tool we are using for even complex part as well. But this is one of the type of mold, and this is a three plate mold. It's a little complex construction. You can see that how the part is ejecting, because we can see the top portion is like, this is a cross section we take. This is the part. So this is the blue color, you can call it as a feed system. So this is a feed system. It's allow the molten material just passing from the injection molding machine. It will pass through the feed system. It will fills the cavity. It forms that one. So this is the pathway. It's called as a feed system. First, while opening the part, it will open the first half. And second, it will open the first half and second half. So it will just remove from the part. The feed system will be separated and part will be separated. After that, the ejection mechanism will eject the part. Part will be fell down. This is a three-plate mold configuration and sequence. Come to stack mold. Stack mold mainly used for the like a multiple part. Suppose the part have a 64 cavity. So in a single shot, it will eject almost 64 part to 120 parts. So you can see the cavity will be arranged in a stack way. That is where it's called as a stack molding. It's one up another. So you can see here also cavity, here also cavity. Biggest advantage is we can just produce a lot of part in a very less clamping force. So that is advantage for the stack molding. These are the important elements of the mold. You can see this is called as a, so because for our mold flow simulation, we need to know this one. This is a feed system. You can see this is called a sprue runner gate, and this is a part. Here you can see this is called as a core. All the gray color is called as a core, and all these areas it's called as a cavity. The holes are called as a cooling lines. So this design also very important, and core and cavity design also very important, and where we are going to give ejection point, that is also very important, and gating location also it's very important. So designing the tool, it's very important because that is where our skill is needed to design the feed system, design the gating option, and design the proper cooling to cool the part. This is a feed system. Feed system have a sprue and primary runner and secondary runner. This is smaller portion, it's called as a gate. So that's where the connection between cavity, like a part and a processing machine. Now come back to the molding defects. These are the general molding defects, like a flow mark and sink mark, vacuum, it's called as a voids, and surface delamination, well line, short shots and warping, burn marks, jetting and flashes. Let's see one by one. So the flow marks. So flow marks, it's a very common one. Because if you are not keeping our mold temperature in a proper way, so it will create flow marks. Because I'll tell in just a simple point, like this is our cross section. So our plastic material will be flows like this way. flows like a fountain flow. So the material will be just formed like this. Center it will go forms. So while forming, if your surface is very cold or it's not optimized, so you can see the flow marks in an easy way. You won't get that proper results or proper finish. So that's where the flow mark will become. Come to a sink mark. I already explained that. You can see there is a sink. There is a depression on the surface of the part because of the different thickness. You can find this kind of problem everywhere. If you are keeping the tool, if you are avoiding this sink mark for the crystalline metal, it creates voids inside. You can see the next defects. Some thicker portion, the voids will be created. You can see how the voids is creating. Like suppose this is a cross section. So this is where the feature is coming. So this is a chunky feature. Because here the chunky feature. So these are all the cold area, the molten area. So the cold area, it's allow all it's pull it like this. It pull it like this, the center cold metal. Because the central metal will be in the molten state. It will easily expand or it like it's allowed the metal to cold, go on cold. So while stretching everywhere, it creates voids in the center, in the thicker section. That's where the void is creating. So we have to pack it properly to avoid these kind of defects. And come to the surface delamination. Again, this is it's a kind of difference in temperature or difference in it. Sometimes the material will be degrade due to that over melting temperature. It creates this kind of delamination problem. Coming to the well line, some of the feature, like you can see the holes will always create a well line. So because the material will be flow, it comes and it will divert, it will go on again, it will join. So while joining, it will create a well line. So we cannot avoid the well line. So we can just strengthen the well line from the breakage. That's where it's possibility. And short. So again, if you are the plastic metal for the thumb rule, I can say, so we can design the plastic material for the generic processing. You can go till up to 0.8. Even the thin wall part also available. That needs a special design for the mold. But for the generic part, if you're keeping the part less than 0.8 mm, it creates short. Or sometimes the part, it's too long, so it creates short. Because of the material and because of the design and because of the tooling, the short will be created. And warping, so you can see how the warp is in the blue part. And see the red color part is how good. Because the warp is due to that internal stress, that is depends on the temperature depends on the overpacking pressure or cooling. It's plenty of thing is involved in this one. And coming to the burn mark, I already explained. So if you are not properly escape the air will be sometimes it will go and bust that location. It will create a burn mark. You can see how the burning is here. And jetting, so mostly the jetting comes for thickest. Sometimes we cannot avoid the part thickness. Sometimes the part will be goes 8 mm thickness or 10 mm thickness. Gate will be placed on the center of the part. So that time it will create a jetting. So for that, we have a different kind of gating options to avoid this kind of jettings. And flashes, so we have to determine how much force is required to close the tool. So if you are not properly defined the tool force, closing force, then it creates a lot of flashes. Flashes means like excess material it forms around the parting line. Come to that, why the mold flow simulation is needed. So now I think many people you understand. So we saw that very complex behavior between the material and processing. So we cannot sit and just make the tool and say if you have a machine and just sitting in front of machine, you cannot do that. So that's where the need to understand the relation between the processing and the part quality. So and the personal skills, how your skills is in the material and tooling and processing, the product design. So that all involves to put all your thoughts in this and optimize the parts. That's where we need to do this Moldflow simulation. And just I want to cover the history of Moldflow. So this is a very oldest software. It's founded by 1978 by Colin Astin. He is an Australian guy. So you can see till now it's almost 40 years gone. So he named the company called Moldflow. Till now that name is there today. And initially they started with the lay flat, like our cardboard box is the right. Just you can just open the boxes and keep it and keep that flow length. That's where the lay flat approach is they done in the early 80s. Then after that, they find all CAE and finite element analysis after came. So they started adopting this one. So this is where the Moldflow is started like 1970, it is established, and 96 it's moved from Australia to Boston, America, and that's where the advisor two modules is available. That is advisor, it's very very basic, so you cannot dive inside and just modify, understand that it's a very very basic module. You can understand that one, but the other one is like insight. It's having more number of customization and more freedom to do our thoughts and find the solution. And 2000, the Moldflow completed initial public offering and stock to acquire C-Mold, because initially the CAD mold, C-Mold is called as a CAD mold, because after 80s, they start adapting the CAD model directly to the Moldflow. So that's where the C-Mold is having a tie-up with the Moldflow. Then it's totally acquired from the C-Mold, and this is the history. Now the Autodesk is acquires Moldflow. So now it's the Moldflow with Autodesk.